headed back to Jerusalem. You think he was kind of anxious about going back to Jerusalem? If we remember correctly, he was there at the stoning of Stephen. And when all the rest of the disciples then were dispersed and all the people that were following Christ were then dispersed around the land, because Saul had already persecuted people in Jerusalem. And here he is now going back. You think you want to go back there? Would you think that you would be all raring to go and say, sure, I want to go there, I want to go back and see the people there, I want to see and tell them how much I've changed? Or do you think there was apprehension in his voice? Or worry? We worry a lot, you know. Do you think he worried about going back to a place that he knew when they seen him, when the disciples seen him, and he was going to the disciples, he could have went back to the Jews, totally and completely, and been fully accepted. But that is not the group he was going back to. He was going to go to the disciples, to the ones that he had been persecuting. Did he go by himself? No. He had this friend that was with him, you know, because Saul was on the road to Damascus, and he seen Jesus Christ. First of all, it took Stephen's prayers for him to be on the road to Damascus, because Stephen prayed for him when he was dying. It took Ananias, who God had called, to go in and talk to Saul as he was the blind man in a house. And Ananias, remember, he didn't want to go either, because he knew what Paul did. I'm going to switch to Paul, okay? Because he knew what Paul had done. And now there's one more that God has sent to help, and that's Barnabas. Barnabas went with Paul to see the disciples. Barnabas was the one that stood up for him and said, wait a minute, he's changed, he's totally different. Paul didn't even give them that message, Barnabas did. His friend said, wait a minute, I'm going to vouch for him. He is now changed totally and completely. He is no longer the man that was filled with hatred. He is now the man that is filled with the love of Jesus Christ in his heart. We have put it here in simple words. It didn't take very long for that story to be told. But he told, Barnabas would have told him all the things that Paul had been doing in Damascus. How people were coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ. How he was changing lives. And imagine the life change for Paul himself. To go from one that is persecuted, to go from one that hated the name of Jesus Christ, and now he has changed to the one that loves the name of Jesus Christ. So here he is, proclaiming the message. I don't think it happened overnight. It never usually does. But if you are gathered with the disciples here, there would have been much prayer about this. They would have gathered together with themselves to try to find out what God was saying to them with Paul being there. It wasn't just on Barnabas' word. Barnabas brought him. But when we really want to know something and we really want to know how God is, what God wants us to do, we have to go to God. We just don't go to Barnabas. And these were prayer warriors. These were people of prayer. And I can see these disciples all banding together and Barnabas and Paul sitting over here just away for a while. Not only were the disciples praying, but Barnabas and Paul were also praying. Because he had been chosen and called by God. And they all wanted the same thing. They wanted the wisdom and the knowledge of God and the Holy Spirit assuring them that what they were stepping on and where they were going was exactly and directly from God. And it had to be from God. Because he met with them and he stayed with them and he went out and he preached with them. I'm also amazed at the people, that the Jews that were there at that time that they were hearing Paul preach about Jesus Christ. Do you think that ruffled any feathers at all? Do you think, is he gone nuts? Is he really crazy? He's a Jew, and now he's proclaiming that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? It ruffled many, many feathers. And yet he was bold to proclaim the name of Christ. It did not diminish him in one way, shape, or form. This is what God called him for, was to go out and proclaim that Jesus Christ was the Son of God. Not necessarily to the Jews, but he had to start there. Paul was sent to the Gentiles across the land to tell them and proclaim to them who this Jesus Christ really was and what he did and how he saved us and how he forgives our sins. That was his message to the people over and over again. Because we have, in most of our lives, have become so subtly into knowing Christ, we don't have this big explosion that, or big change in our hearts and our lives. Because we truly believe that we've known Jesus Christ all our lives. And some of us have. But some of us, it gets so common and so ordinary with it, we don't get excited about that. Our heart doesn't race any faster if we're thinking we're talking to Christ. Not at all. We just kind of have this mediocre, mellow, laid back, almost, sorry I'm going to use this word, dead religion. Because we are so common and so ordinary with it that we do not get excited about what Jesus Christ does in our lives. A gentleman that we had heard the other day, and his name was Larry, and one of the song people up there that directs music, he started out in song, "Larry's in the Need of Prayer." And they just sang that. "Larry's in the need of prayer, Larry's in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer." Only they put, Larry was standing in the need of prayer. And through this, Larry had been down to Rochester 10 times. He had a bleeding inside of him that would not quit. It would not go away. So he was going down the 10th time. After they sang that song and he talked to his wife, he said, "You know, I think this is a wasted trip for us to go down there. Totally and completely wasted." But they went anyway. He says, "I got up back up on that cold table again so they could look again." And the surgeon went in and looked and he said, "You know, I don't know why you're here. Go home. There's nothing wrong with you." That should excite us. That should make us jump up and down for joy, because Jesus Christ was the one that touched that person. Jesus touched Larry. But he touched Larry by the prayers of the people. There's so much that we need to be excited about, but we are so laid back. We stop knowing how to be excited about what Jesus Christ is doing in the lives of people. I have a lady up there, she sent me a letter, her name is Gail, and she says, "I'm praying for you." As soon as I signed up, she said, "You're on my prayer list, I'm praying for you." And I could tell in my life that somebody was praying for me. I could tell. Things had changed. And I had such a desire that was building within. And I got up there and I signed the papers and signed in, and I hadn't been there 20 minutes and she found me out. Somebody had to go tell her I was there. But she found me out. Literally, just real tiny small energy that you would not believe. And she says, "I've been praying for you every day. Absolutely every day since you signed up." And so she said, "I am so glad to meet you." She said, "I feel like I already know you." And this little lady just kind of buzzed all over the place that was there. And so she was at another meeting, and finally she said she'd been at the church all her life. And they asked her, "How old are you? How old are you?" And she was tiny, but she was moving all over. She was 82 years old. She was excited about knowing Jesus Christ. She was excited about being there and praying for people that they might come to know Jesus Christ. It was an amazing time to be there, because most of the people in that church are over 50 years old. They have no kids. There's no kids around, none whatsoever. But They know that their group age is 50 and above, and that's what they work with, is 50 and above. 10 years ago, they built a new church. They have a lot of little groups that go out there, but during the summer, their attendance is 225 people. All of them over 50 years old. Some maybe at 30, but mostly older ones. During the winter, it's 75. But the 75 keep on the work all the way through. Their congregation, actually, is the ones that lead the church. The pastor says, they go and I run behind saying, wait, your leader is here. Because they have excitement of what God is doing. Paul could not go any place but to the disciples. He had to go there. Because the excitement in him was that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. There is power, there is authority in the name of Jesus Christ. There is no other name under heaven in which you can come to know the Lord God completely and totally. And he was also filled with the Holy Spirit, and that took another saint to walk up to him, lay hands on him, pray for him that he would be anointed with the Holy Spirit. All of us are so valuable in this ministry here. This is all of our ministries. This is not my ministry. This is all of ours. But we need to kind of wake up and be aroused about what God really wants us to be and who he wants us to be. Can we go from 20 or 25 or 30 to 200? No, I do not believe that at all. But I can believe we can have the same excitement that they do, the same passion that they do, right here in this place. Because it's not about how a church, it's about following the Lord Jesus Christ. It's about telling others why you love him, why you serve him, why you want to know him. What does he do for you? But how much he also blesses you when you bless others. This little church that's up there, I can't even call it, they call themselves small. I call us little now, because small doesn't fit. A 200 member church is small, so we have to go down to little on that. But they have no grandchildren at all. But they have no children at all, but all of them that are sitting there are considering themselves grandparents to any child that is in the community, any radius around. They all want to be grandparents for them. So they find out the names of the children that are around, and they begin praying for them. They also take out, they have families that are willing to step up and say, okay, it's time for school. These are our children. We need parents or adults. Our grandparents that will go out with these children and help them buy school supplies. And they will do that. They will take a child out, buy school supplies, two outfits, a pair of shoes, and a new coat for school. And it doesn't come out of the church budget. It comes out of the people's pockets. Too long we have sat in the pew and thought that's good enough. Too long we have waited here and wanted to hear the voice of God. And we have. But when we leave here, what do we do with that? What do we do with that? When Saul heard the voice of Jesus Christ and saw Jesus Christ, he changed completely. He was not the man he was before. Because he had a desire within that Christ had put in there and knew that he had called him to go out and preach the word. I am not the only preacher in this place. You all are. Because you do it with love and compassion. You know, if we like something, if we think something is unique and amazing, we tell other people about it. We tell over and over again. You know, I said, if you ask anybody that went out and seen the eclipse, you can hear more about the eclipse than you ever wanted to hear in your whole life. But they will tell you because it made them excited, and they'll do it again and again and again. It's an eclipse. Christ. He is by far better and greater than any eclipse that is out there. So, I know it sounds like the same sermon over and over again, but that's what the disciples, and that's what the word says. Go and tell. Tell them why you love the Lord Jesus Christ, and if you can't figure it out, talk with him. Lord, what do I say to them? The one got up this morning, got up in the morning, and she said, Lord, open my eyes that I can see what you want me to see. Take the blinders off. Stop me being from so busy that I am just doing this and this and this, and the rest of the world is just, don't even see that. Don't even know that. There's a little old lady that sits in Wilmer, and I've seen her twice. I cannot read the sign as you go by. She sits out and come out from Walmart. And she just sits there, but I don't know what the sign says because you don't see it at 20 miles an hour and my eyes aren't that good. Anyway, you know, and the other day I seen a lady that had stopped and was talking with her. You know, I still don't know what she wants, but I've been guilty every time I went past that. Anybody want to join me in that?
Yes.
We have words, but our best word and our most powerful word is Jesus Christ. There is power in that name, and Saul knew that when he changed to Paul, that his power came from Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. That's our same power. Our power was bought by the blood of Jesus Christ, his power. The authority that we have comes from God, and it comes from Jesus Christ, bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. The life we live in of faith was because of the cross. The life when we sing and rejoice was because of the nails. There is power in the blood of Jesus Christ. There is power in the name of Jesus Christ. We just have to live life.